Welcome to News Click. We have with us Josy Joseph, who is fighting the biggest defamation case till date as an individual. It is a case of worth 1,000 crores launched by the Jet Airways company and Mr. Naresh Goyal. Welcome to News Click. It's a privilege to have you with us. And before that, I'd read your book. It's a wonderful book, and everybody should look at this book, because if you want to know how India is operating presently, how everything that you see outside are not what it seems, if you look at this book, you would know how the deals are done behind the veil of democracy, that we all believe the democracy is what is running our nation, but if you know, it is the politicians and the business oligarchy that runs the country. What is the status of the case, sir? Because people are watching closely. There are many individuals who have been tamed, if you can say, but you are standing guard and everybody is looking up to you. So what is the status of the case so that people can get strength from you and how you're fighting this case? Yeah.
So there are two cases. Yeah. One is filed against Outlook magazine and me. Because Outlook magazine and its editors had carried an extract of a chapter on Naresh Goyal and Jet Airways and their alleged links to underworld. Right. The other case is against the publisher, my book publisher, HarperCollins and me. Yeah. In the case of the Outlook and me, the case against Outlook and me, we are in the process of filing our response, and we'll be filing it next week. And we have prepared a very strong and aggressive response. There is not an iota of regret nor doubt about what we have said or what we are going to say. In fact, ever since the court case started, I have also been getting a lot of whistleblowers calling out to me, reaching out to me with more information on Jet Airways and their criminal links, especially of Naresh Goyal, the promoter. So we are actually going to be presenting a lot of additional documents. And we hope it triggers a closer scrutiny of the kind of business that's being done in this country by many of the corporates. In the second case, I'm coordinating very well with my publishers. They're also standing by me. As you know, HarperCollins is part of the Rupert Murdoch empire. Right. So they're also coordinating. I'm coordinating with their lawyers in London, in Bombay, in Delhi, etc. We are in the process of filing the response, and it takes time. Yeah. It involves some money, but there are also a lot of good people out there. For example, Prashant Bhushan has pro bono vetted my filings from Delhi, and in Mumbai, Mihir Deshai, who is one of our finest public interest lawyers in Mumbai at the Bombay High Court, he is fighting my case. All court cases are cumbersome. It takes a lot of time, energy drains you. But I think, and that is their intention. It is not that they very well know that nobody is going to pay them 1,000 crores, even if they win the case. But the game is to wear you out, to ensure that your votes do not reach as many people as possible, to use the court case as a cover for furthering their business interest. So while I understand the limitations of Indian judiciary and the time it takes, we would be fighting the case aggressively on the front foot. And I hope I would have the same level of energy and commitment to the case as it drags on for years, which is usually the case.
Sir, in your career as a journalist, you have broken very important cases, be it the Adarsh apartment scam or even the Naval War Room leak case, and also the Commonwealth Games. So how was it? Every time you broke a story, it was in national news and even the 2G scam. So you were able to shake the might of the country. I think
George Orwell, I think, is famously said that journalism is printing what others don't want it to print. So everything else is public relations, and which is true it's a bigger truth today than ever. So I believe in it. And second thing is, I think as journalists, we are supposed to be adversarial towards all powers that be, whether it's a government or corporates or whoever. If that is the case, then all of us should be writing things that are critical of the establishments and corporate houses and political parties and political establishments. So maybe I was lucky, maybe I'm persistent, maybe I keep moving from story to story. I don't know what it is, but over the last 20-25 years, many stories that I've done. But if you ask me what is that one thing common about all these stories, there are a few things. One is that I believe, and it should be so, that journalists should believe in the fact that we are not the story. We are only the flies on the wall who are just reporting the story. So once I report a story, then I move on to the next story. A lot of journalists make the mistake of reporting the story and then they talk about and become the heroes of the story. And they become the story and then they are lost in it for a lifetime, for years. I try to avoid that. That's one thing. Second thing is, I approach stories in an academic fashion. I think I'm doing an academic research. So I have to be as soundproof as possible. So if I'm able to present a very academically sound evidence, it's very difficult to refute it. Third thing is that when you do any of these things, you are taking on powerful and mighty people, and obviously there are adverse reactions to it. So because of that, I think the third and the most crucial part of the game is how to play down your fear. It's not that I don't have fears, you know, I also have my fears, but so it's all a combination of all these factors that I think helps me or journalists like me to keep doing stories and keep moving forward.
In your piece, you had become very philosophical when you talk about the interest between the opposition and the ruling parties. You say that when it comes to sharing the pie, there is no difference. I quote, "When it comes to sharing the pie or claiming a piece of it, there are no political divisions." Why did you feel that? Because at least in the people see that the opposition members and the ruling parties are always at war with each other.
So if you look at my book, what is it that I've tried to do? I've tried to explain the reality of Indian democracy that the average reader wouldn't know. The stories of the capital city and beyond, which while some of us would know, wouldn't even report, which usually are consumed in the gossip parties of in the manicured lawns. So I wanted to tell the story of the real story of Indian democracy without any varnish. Right. So if that is the aim, then I have to go beyond what is obvious on television screen or on newspapers. And that is where I'm trying to say that there is a tacit understanding between all kinds of politicians, politics, to the extent that there is an equilibrium that they've created. In that equilibrium, they will together run the Cricket Control Board of India because that's a rich board. I mean, if their political rivalries were real, how could Rajiv Shukla and Anurag Thakur and everybody sit together and decide the fate of Indian cricket? And Narendra Modi and Amit Shah, they are all cricket administrators. Right. I mean, I used to be a cricket player for a long time in my life. You know, I when I look at some of these chaps, I don't even know whether they can bend to hold a bat or to bowl a good ball, you know. But it's embarrassing and it's also a telling story of our times that they all come together. And there is a grand conspiracy of silence amongst them when it's coming to sharing the pie. For example, one fundamental question that every Indian politician should be answering and should be making clear is, how are they funding their politics? How did Mr. Modi put up so many holograms all over the country? How did he fly around in chartered aircraft? How did his party fly around in helicopters? Was it with that just 740 crore rupees that he declared as BJP's expense in 2014? No, my dear, it's not. Did the Congress run its 2014 campaign with a few hundred crore rupees? No. The market estimates were that about 20,000 crore rupees was spent in 2014 elections. So where is the rest of the money coming? Where is it going? Who is spending it? So the underground of Indian politics, they all want to cover up. Right. And that underground of politics, its coffers are being filled by the black money from corporates and other vested interests, arms dealers and whatnot. Yeah. So there is a grand conspiracy beyond it. The day you break open that grand conspiracy, the day we crack that, the day we forced our politicians to shed their dubious lifestyles and shed their dubious political positions, we will have a mature liberal democracy.
Yeah, in that sense, you talked about the armed forces. You had also mentioned in the book that there is a clear link how when the foreign arms dealers are coming for their business, there is always the foreign diplomats engage the industrialists to help in the defense deals. Can you throw some light how it happens?
So that is in the section about intermediaries. I've spoken in detail about several kinds of intermediaries. So one of the most influential intermediaries are the ones who can get you the big $1 billion deal from the government of India. Yeah. So I focus mostly on the arms dealers because that's one area where I've really worked on for years. You know, I don't think many Indians are even aware that a one-eyed man living in a mansion in London controls world's arms industry to a great extent, and he's an Indian. without his blessings, most deals in India won't go through. He also owns some of the world's biggest collection of paintings. He owns Emma Fusain and Andy Warhol and all that. Now, people like that, whether they are little known or whether they are famous businessmen, they all become intermediaries for big defense companies to swing their deals. So if you look at the present disposition, you can see that the Modi government, it has its own favorite industrialist who, without any business background, how come they come to play such important role in Indian business sector? These are high-end technological sectors. You think how do you explain a business house getting to play crucial role in manufacturing fighters and tanks when they have never in their life manufactured anything like that? So there is something beyond what is obvious, and that is the obvious thing. Beyond the obvious is what I was trying to search, and right. and I didn't want the book to be gossipies, so I only recorded what is on in documents.
Right.
So that's why limited to that. But what I know, and what the market knows, and what the people who matter knows, is that some of our biggest industrialists are actually mere middlemen. They make their big money either fixing contracts for you. They're fixing big contracts in government and collecting the kickbacks and distributing the kickbacks to the parties and to the politicians and their families and moving the money around. That is what some of our big industrialists are doing, nothing more.
Currently, you're the national security editor at The Hindu. So you would know with this, and the war industry is always looking for troubled areas. So do you think with the private sector where their main aim is to see profits, do you think there can be some internal disturbances, or we are always at war-ready country, or how do you see any of that sort happening?
No, I mean, there are two, three things to be discussed, to look at here, what do you say? Number one is that are we going to create a military-industrial complex that is powerful enough to create disturbances and artificial conflicts? Right now, we don't have it, but we could be susceptible to it. So we need to be very, very careful, and we need to watch out to ensure that our democratic institutions, the parliament, the security establishments are so honest and with so much integrity that they can be a check on the private military-industrial complex that will emerge ultimately.
Okay.
Are our government institutions powerful enough and independent enough today? No. If a private military-industrial complex rise today, our security establishment and our parliamentary mode of governance is not good enough today. We have very serious governance crisis. So we need to work on strengthening them. Can these people create conflicts? Of course, they could and they will, because for them it's business, pure effort. So if you look at, I don't know if you have been following the entire scandal around Rolls-Royce company, which makes the aircraft engines and ship engines and all that. It turned out that the one-eyed Sudhir Chaudhary that I speak about in my book,
yeah.
He was his agent in both China and India. So India-China conflict brings him more money and brings more money to Rolls-Royce.
Sure.
So it's not rocket science.
Yeah.
But how do you balance it out is by strengthening our security establishments, by strengthening parliamentary accountability, which we do not have. Today you have a security establishment, especially the intelligence agencies, which are almost recklessly let loose. They need to be accountable.
Now coming back to the most important thing, as a journalist, you have been like a soldier. Your training in the army has helped you stay firm and focused in your fight against the corporates. So what is your advice to the budding journalists who look up to you as a role model?
There are a few things of life skills that I think anybody, not just journalists, any professional who's entering life should have. Most important is to come to terms with money. You know, if you are going to be chasing money for a lifetime, then you will end up compromising yourself at every stage. So it is about deciding, okay, is this shirt enough for you, or you want more expensive shirt and shoes, or are you happy with it, or are you and your family happy with living in a DD apartment in the edge of the city, and are you happy driving your car for an hour and a half one way, or do you want to be in the center of the city? So those things make a lot of impact on what your values are. Once you are clear and your relationship with money is settled, then a lot of things will fall into place. That's one thing. The second thing is journalism, especially, and most professions, don't approach them with the presuming that glamour of what you see in films or books is what it is. No, it is a very boring, tedious job. So beyond the books, beyond what you hear about me, is I spent days, hours, months sometimes looking at documents and find nothing. Right? There are moments when people humiliate you, but you have to just swallow that and move on. That's second thing. The third thing is that, to me, the more tricky part is not the threats to life or, you know, intimidations or legal cases. The more dangerous part to me is how do you equip yourself to resist temptations.
Right.
So, you know, when you come from a family, middle class family, and when you are living in my kind of conditions, how do you say no to a 10 crore rupee offer to be quiet? And most of the time, money or other gifts are being offered for your silence. Nobody will even know. So even your life partner wouldn't know that you have taken money from somebody or bribe from somebody. How do you ensure that your morality is protected in that very lonely moments? So I think both excellence and morality are very very, very lonely pursuits. There is nobody else with you in these games. So if you want to write a book, you'll have to get up in the morning, write every morning. You can't call a crowd of friends and sit and write.
Right.
Similarly about values. If all that is settled, then I think it's fun because you should look at the sunshine, not at the shadows.
So watch out, nationalists. Here we have a journalist who is saying commitment and ethics are important, and that is what is required even for you nationalists who just go by the mere popular TV channels that have the backing of the ruling establishment. But it is important that you see between the words and look for people who are honest and for the service of the nation. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.